The following contents are covered: electric heating, resistance ovens, and radiant heating. Electric heating. In number of cases where heating is required, the use of electrically produced heat is nowadays an economical proposition on account of the present low cost and availability of electrical energy. Electrical heating is extensively used both for domestic and industrial applications. The domestic applications include room heaters, immersion heaters for water heating, hot plates for cooking, electric kettles, electric irons, electric ovens for bakeries, and electric toasters. Industrial applications of electric heating include melting of metals, heat treatment of metals like drying, annealing, tempering, soldering, welding, brassing, molding of glass, baking of insulators, enameling of copper wires. All the heating requirements can be met by some form of electric heating equipment. Electric heating methods. The different types of electric heating methods are: when current is passed through a resistive element, heat is produced because of I square R loss. When eddy currents are induced in the material, the heat is produced. When a magnetic material is brought in the vicinity of magnetic field, heat is produced in the magnetic material due to the hysteresis loss. The dielectric loss produced in an insulating material kept between two conducting plates across which AC voltage is applied heats up the insulating material. When the surface of a material is bombarded with high energy particles, the body is heated up. Advantages of electric heating method over other heating systems. Economical. Electric heating is economical because the electric furnaces are cheaper since the initial cost as well as the maintenance cost is low because they don't require bigger space for installation or for the storage of coal and wood. Cleanliness. Since the heating process is free from dust and ash, it is a clean system of heating and also cleaning cost is rendered to minimum. Also, the material doesn't get contaminated. No pollution. Since there are no flue gases produced in electric heating, this method is pollution free. Automatic protection. Automatic protection against overcurrents or overheating is provided through suitable switch gears in this method of heating. Ease of control. It is easy to control and regulate the temperature with the help of manual or automatic devices. So temperature can be controlled within 5 degrees Celsius, which is not possible by any other form of heating. Upper limit of temperature. There is no upper limit of the temperature which is obtained except the ability of the material to withstand the heat. Special heating requirements. The certain heating requirements such as uniform heating of a material or heating one particular portion of the job without affecting its other part, heating of non-conducting materials, heating with no oxidation can be met only in this heating method. Better working conditions. Since electric heating produces no irritating noise and also the radiation loss is less, it results in low ambient temperature. Also, working with electric furnaces is convenient and cool. Higher efficiency. The overall efficiency of electric heating is comparatively high compared to the other types of heating because in this system of heating, the source is brought directly to the point where heat is required, thereby reducing the losses. Safety. Electric heating is quite safe because it responds quickly to the controlled signals. Heating of insulating materials. The insulating materials can be heated only by electric heating method. Wood, plastic, and bakery items can be uniformly and suitably heated by dielectric heating. Low maintenance cost. The electric heating equipment generally will not require much attention and supervision, and hence their maintenance cost is almost negligible. Modes of heat transfer. There are three ways by which the heat is transferred from the heat source to the material which has to be heated. First is conduction. In this mode of heat transfer, the heat is transferred from one part of the substance to the other part from molecule to molecule due to the temperature gradient between the two parts without the actual movement of the molecules. In solids, the heat is transferred by this method of heat transfer. Convection. In this type of heat transfer, the heat is transferred from one part of the substance to the other part by actual movement of the heated molecules. Heat in water and air is transferred by convection. The rate of heat dissipated by convection, it is given by H equal to A into T1 minus T2 to the power B in watt per meter square, where A and B are the constant whose value depends upon the type of heating surface, and T1 and T2 are the temperatures of the heating surface and the fluid in degree Celsius absolute. For vertical surfaces, the value of A is 3.875 and B is 1.25. Next mode of heat transfer is radiation. In this, the heat reaches the substance to be heated from the source of heat without heating the medium in between. The rate of heat radiation is given by Stefan's law. It is H equal to 5.72 into 10 to the power 4 Ke into T1 by 1000 to the power 4 minus T2 by 1000 to the power 4 in watt per meter square, where T1 is the temperature of the source of heat in degree Celsius absolute, T2 is the temperature of the substance to be heated in degree Celsius absolute, K is a constant known as radiant efficiency. The value of K is 1 for single element and it varies from 0.5 to 0.8 for several elements placed side by side. E is the emissivity. E is 1 for black body and 0.9 for resistance heating elements. Classification of electric heating methods. Electric heating is broadly classified into power frequency heating and high frequency heating. In power frequency heating, we have two types, resistance heating and arc heating. In resistance heating, there are two types, direct resistance heating and indirect resistance heating. Similarly, in arc heating, there are two types, direct arc heating and indirect arc heating. In high frequency heating, there are two types, induction heating and dielectric heating. In induction heating, we have two types, direct induction heating and indirect induction heating. Direct resistance heating. In this, the electric current, it is made to pass through the body which is to be heated. Application is in resistance welding, electrode boiler for heating water. Next is indirect resistance heating. In this, the electric current is made to pass through a wire or other high resistance material which forms the heating element. The heat which is developed, it is transferred from the heating element to the body which is to be heated by the mode of transfer of heat, radiation or convection. Usually, this method is used in immersion heaters, resistance ovens, domestic and commercial cooking and heat treatment of metals. Infrared or radiant heating. The heat energy from an incandescent lamp, it is focused upon the body which is to be heated up in the form of electromagnetic radiations. Application is to dry the wet paints on an object. Next is arc heating. The arc drawn between two electrodes develops high temperature of the order of 3000 to 3500 degrees Celsius depending upon the electrode material. The electric arc may be used in the different ways, such as by striking the arc between the charge and the electrode or electrodes. In this method, the heat is directly conducted to the charge. The furnace operating on this principle is known as direct arc furnace. Next, by striking the arc between the two electrodes. In this method, the heat is transferred to the charge by radiation. The furnace operating on this principle is known as indirect arc furnace. Next, by striking an arc between an electrode and two metallic pieces to be joined, as in the case of arc welding. Direct induction heating. In this method of heating, the currents are induced by electromagnetic action in the body to be heated. When these currents flow through the resistance of the body to be heated, it develops heat and thus raises the temperature. In induction furnace, heat is used to melt the charge, and eddy current heaters are used for heat treatment of metals. Indirect induction heating. In this method of electric heating, the eddy currents are induced in the heating element by the electromagnetic action. These eddy currents produce heat in the heating element, which is transferred to the body which is to be heated up by radiation and convection. Some of the induction ovens used for heat treatment of metals operate on this principle. Dielectric heating. In this method of electric heating, the use of dielectric loss is made to heat the non-metallic materials. Non-metallic material to be heated is placed between the two metal electrodes across which high voltage at high frequency is applied, and the heat is developed due to the dielectric loss taking place. Resistance heating. The resistance heating, it is based on I square R effect. When current passes through a resistive element, I square R loss takes place, which produces heat. This method of heating, it has wide applications such as heat treatment of metals, drying and baking of potteries, stoving of enameled ware, and in commercial and domestic cooking. Temperature up to about 1000 degrees Celsius is obtained in ovens which employs wire resistances as heating elements. There are two methods of resistance heating: direct resistance heating and indirect resistance heating. Direct resistance heating. The figure shows the setup for direct resistance heating. In this method of heating, the material or the charge which is to be heated is treated as a resistance and current is passed through it. The charge used may be in the form of powder or small solid pieces or liquid. The electrodes are immersed in the charge and connected to the supply. Two electrodes will be required in the case of DC or single phase AC supply, and three electrodes in the case of three phase supply. When the charge is in the form of small pieces, then powder of high resistivity material is sprinkled over the surface of the charge so that direct short circuit can be avoided. The current flows through the charge and heat is thus produced. This method of heating has high efficiency because the heat produced is in the charge itself. Next is indirect resistance heating. The setup shown is for indirect resistance heating. In this method of heating, the current is passed through a wire or other high resistance material which forms the heating element. The heat produced is due to I square R loss. It is produced in the heating element and it is delivered to the charge by one or more modes of the heat transfer. If the heat transfer is by conduction, then the heating element must be in contact with the charge. Whereas an enclosure known as heating chamber is required for the heat transfer by radiation or convection for the charge. For the industrial purpose where large amount of charge is to be heated, then the heating element is placed in a cylinder which is surrounded by the charge which is placed in the jacket. This arrangement, it provides a uniform temperature and also automatic temperature control can be provided. Resistance ovens. According to the operating temperature, the resistance furnaces can be classified into various types. Low temperature heating chamber with the provision for ventilation is termed as oven. The resistance ovens are used for heat treatment of metals, drying and baking potteries, drying varnish coatings, vulcanizing and hardening of synthetic materials, and in commercial and domestic cooking. The medium temperature furnaces having operating temperature between 300 to 1050 degrees Celsius, they are employed for annealing, normalizing of steel and non-ferrous metals, melting of non-ferrous metals, and stove enameling. High temperature furnaces, they have operating temperature between 1050 degrees Celsius to 1350 degrees Celsius and are employed for hardening applications. Resistance ovens. The furnaces operating at low temperature are called as resistance ovens. Typical furnace using heating elements and having provision of carrying out the heat into the particular atmosphere is shown in the figure. The resistance oven, it is constructed of firebricks or other heat insulating material supported on metal framework. The heating elements, they are mounted on the top, sides or bottom of the oven according to the circumstance. The resistance furnace, it is an enclosure with refractory lining, a surrounding layer of heat insulation and outer casing of steel plate or bricks or tiles. The inside portion of heating chamber is made to suit the character of the charge and the type of furnace or oven. The nature of the material required for the insulation, it is determined by the maximum temperature of the inner face of the heating chamber. Requirements of heating material. A material used as heating element should have the following properties: high specific resistance, so that only small quantity of wire is required to produce given amount of heat; high melting point, so that high temperatures can be produced without jeopardizing the life of heating element; freedom from oxidation at high temperatures so that the long life of heating element is ensured. Small temperature coefficient so that the resistance does not change with the temperature increase. Considering this, the material which most satisfactorily fulfills these requirements at a reasonable cost are either alloys of nickel and chromium containing about 80% of nickel, or alloys of nickel 65%, chromium 15% and iron 20%. Efficiency and losses of resistance ovens. The heat produced in the heating element not only raises the temperature of the charge to the desired value, but also it is used to overcome the losses occurring due to the heat used in raising the temperature of the oven or furnace, heat used in raising the temperature of containers or carriers, heat conducted through the walls, heat loss due to opening of the oven door. So the efficiency of the oven, it is defined as the ratio of heat required to raise the temperature of the charge to the desired value to the heat required to raise the temperature of the charge and losses. The heat required to raise the temperature of the charge to the required value can be calculated as H equal to weight of charge into specific heat into rise in temperature, that is H equal to MST joules, where M is the weight of the charge in kg, S is the specific heat of the charge in joules per kg per degree Celsius, T is the temperature rise in degree Celsius. The heat used to raise the temperature of the oven can be calculated if the weight and specific heat of the refractory lining is known. It is denoted by H11. It is given by H11 equal to weight of the oven into specific heat into rise in temperature. In case the oven is used continuously, then this loss is negligible. The heat used to raise the temperature of containers or carriers, it is calculated in the same way as heat used to raise the temperature of oven or furnace. It is denoted by H12. H12 is equal to weight of containers into specific heat into rise in temperature. The container, it has to be heated usually every time the furnace is charged. Next is heat conducted through the oven walls. It can be calculated knowing the mean value of the inside and outside surface area A in square meters, thickness of the walls T in meters, inside temperature and outside temperature T1 and T2 degrees Celsius, and thermal conductivity of the walls K. It is denoted by H13. H13 equal to Ka by T into T1 minus T2. Next is heat loss due to opening of the oven door. There is no specific formula to determine the heat loss occurring due to opening of the oven door for charging or inspection purpose, but this loss is known by experience. It is taken as 0.575 to 1.15 megajoules per square meter of the door area if the door is opened for a period of 20 to 30 seconds. It is denoted by H14. Therefore, the efficiency is given by H by H plus H11 plus H12 plus H13 plus H14. Applications of resistance furnaces. For the greater part, the resistance furnace is used for medium temperature work. Some of the applications are for metals, heating for case hardening, annealing, general heat treating, melting lead, tin, zinc, etc., and vitreous enameling. For ceramics, treating china earthware. For chemical purpose, cracking of gases. For miscellaneous use, cremation furnaces. Next, high temperature furnaces. They employ non-metallic resistors and are used for hardening high-speed steels, for melting non-ferrous metals, glass, and for treating ceramic materials. Control equipment for resistance ovens. Control of the temperature, it is necessary in resistance ovens and it is achieved by adjusting the current in the elements. So the temperature can be kept constant or varied according to the requirement, and this control, it is done either manually or automatically. Operating voltage. The resistance ovens, they operated at low voltages of 240 volt or 415 volt, either DC or single phase AC or three phase AC supply. Since normal ratings are not more than 50 to 60 kilowatt, high voltage supply is not necessary. Only in some cases, the ovens up to 300 kilowatt may be used. Control of current. The current in heating elements can be varied by the following methods. Using only some elements at a time. But this gives a non-uniform heating, and to secure better distribution of elements which may be in a circuit at a time only, it complicates the wiring. Next, series parallel connection or star delta arrangement of elements. This method is simple and practically very effective. Next, the use of series resistance in the external circuit. It is wasteful in power and therefore uneconomical, but sometimes it is used for small units due to its low cost and ease of control. Next, variation of transformer tappings. Only applicable in the rare cases where a transformer is used for stepping down the voltage. Next, periodically switching on and off the electric supply. The final temperature, it is the ratio of on time to the summation of on and off time. Next, automatic temperature control. This can be only achieved through thermostats. When the temperature changes beyond certain value, then the thermostat will operate the relay which will control the current by any one of the methods mentioned above. The relay may even switch the oven out of service if required. The actual switching operations are done by the contactors. Next, general protection. This has to be provided against overloads, abnormally high temperatures, and against the possibility of the furnace being loaded or unloaded when the power supply is on. Infrared or radiant heating. In resistance ovens, the heat is transferred from the heating elements to the charge partly by radiation and partly by convection, the latter predominating at low and medium temperatures. An alternative approach is infrared or radiant heating, which is suitable for low and medium temperatures. In this method, the heating elements are made up of tungsten material and operating at about 2300 degrees Celsius, because at this temperature, a greater proportion of infrared radiation is given off. The heating effect on the charge, it is greater because the temperature of the heating element is greater than in the case of resistance heating. The heat emission intensity up to 7500 watts per square meter is obtained, which leads to heat absorption up to 4300 watts per square meter, which reduces the time taken by the various drying processes. Applications are drying of paints, foundry molds, and heating of plastic at low temperature.